It's the beginning of the year. Your company just communicated that you're becoming net zero by 2030. It's time to celebrate. When suddenly that thought hits, wait, but how are we supposed to do this? No panic. Sit tight. We got your back. This, and this are no news to many of us. We live in a climate crisis where rising only 3 degrees Celsius will be catastrophic to the planet. So people are fairly demanding companies and governments to act upon it. That's why today, about half of the largest companies have committed to reduce their emissions. Yet, some companies' emissions reporting still looks like this.
Hello!
Oh, hey there! Hi, Pikla! Can you explain to us why some companies have a hard time measuring emissions?
Because it's quite difficult to measure. 80% of emissions in companies come from their supply chain. This means that the amount of emissions companies must calculate is enormous. But first, let's explain the different types of emissions. Scope 1 emissions are all the emissions that a company produces, like a manufacturing plant or company vehicles. Scope 2 emissions come from all types of energy consumption. Let's say office heating or the energy used when producing a product. Now, scope 3 emissions are absolutely everything else. We're talking about purchased goods and services, business travel, and waste management, to name only a few. This makes measuring scope 3 emissions both super important, but also very, very difficult, as the data is extremely broad and scattered in many places.
Makes sense. But why aren't companies advanced yet?
Because companies are still figuring out how to do it. Although 51% of companies have commitments to reduce emissions, only a few, around 21%, have a clear plan on how to get there.
Thanks for the great explanation, Pikla. Then how can companies best calculate their scope 3 emissions?
Hello!
Welcome, Shreya. Would you take it from here?
Of course. To start with, you need a roadmap. In general, the journey to scope 3 emissions looks something like this. Before starting the whole process, we'd advise ensuring you have one important aspect that companies often forget: sustainability ownership. Meaning, someone in your team leading the projects and making sure reaching targets actually happens. The next step would be calculate your baseline, so basically how much your emissions are, followed by identifying hotspots, so which suppliers or categories you should be focusing on. Now let's go all hands in and start collecting more precise supplier emissions. Finally, start reduction initiatives in order to begin reducing emissions.
Cool, is that it?
Well, kind of, but Alex can go more into details.
Thank you, Shreya.
Thank you.
You can now relax and dance it off. Moi, Alex.
Moika.
The stage is yours.
So now that we have established the roadmap, let's look at calculating your baseline. The first step is to classify your spend to understand what are you buying and who are you buying it from. It is a big task, but thankfully there are partners that can help you with that.
Partners like us.
Then this data can be combined with third-party databases that provide information on how much emissions are being generated from the products or services you have acquired. To put it simply, you can either use the monetary value of your purchase or the quantity you have purchased and compare that information against the databases. Let's say you buy 100 euros worth of avocados from the US. A database can tell you that on average, 1 euro worth of avocados from the US generates 0.3 kilograms of CO2 emissions. However, if your supplier increases the price, it will look like the emissions are increasing as well, which in most cases will not be accurate. Therefore, if your spend data has quantity information available, it will be even more accurate. Let's say you are buying 5 kilograms of avocados from the US. A database can tell you that 1 kilogram of avocados equals to 0.4 kilograms of CO2 emissions. To link your spend data with emission factor databases, you would most often use the name of the material or category. To align these figures, you need to account for currency conversions, unit of measure conversions, and inflation. The combination of these monetary and quantity-based calculations gives you 100% coverage of your spend data, allowing you to not only understand your baseline, but also identify hotspots. Hotspots are important because they tell you whether you should be worrying about flight emissions, a certain supplier or buying organization, or where your avocados are coming from. Now that we've identified our hotspots, we get to the next stage, collecting emission information from these key suppliers. Getting back to the avocados, our database told us that 1 kilo of avocados out of the US generate 0.4 kilos of CO2 emissions. However, if you have a supplier out of California saying 1 kilo of their avocados contribute 0.5 kilos of CO2 emissions, while not ideal, you should use that information. For the time being, we still need to rely heavily on emission databases. The truth is, you have tens of thousands of suppliers who don't always have the emission data available to be shared with you. This is a hybrid model, adopted by most of the leading companies worldwide.
Whew, that was long but insightful.
You like that?
Yes, you rocked it. Now, do companies have to map all this out by themselves?
I'm glad you asked.
What's up, Ville?
Hi. Some companies do go with DIY or consultancies as their options. They may use Excel to try and combine spend data with emission factors, or they might rely on a consultancy to do a one-off analysis of their data. Yet these options naturally have their flaws in requiring a lot of resources, knowledge, but also not showing progress over time. But we have good news. There is a way to automate this via software companies. Specialized solutions can take care of the entire process, so you don't have to, but also giving you ongoing updates. So here are the must-haves that a software tool should have in order to give you advanced understanding of your Scope 3 emissions. Monthly or quarterly refreshes are needed in order to be able to make decisions based on the data. The spent data needs to be taken directly from the ERPs automatically with a good coverage instead of uploading Excel files. The process needs to be accepted by various standards and verified. And the mapping process of emissions, of course, needs to be automated, so you don't have to use time on calculations. All functions need to be able to collaborate together with unlimited users. Finally, ending up in beautiful, user-friendly analytics that you can look at all day.
Nice. Any final comments?
Just remember, even if you get a good tool with features like these, your emissions won't magically decrease. Starting reductions initiatives and finally reducing the emissions is up to you.
Whether you choose to do it yourself or partner with a software company, you really must start now.
The climate has already changed. We see it affecting every day the ones with less privileges in the world. Yet the climate crisis will end up touching us all. Individuals are acting, but they can't fight this alone.
Everything is not lost though, as companies all around the world are setting targets and looking for ways to reduce Scope 3 emissions. And this is where procurement plays a key role.
And now you know how. Create an efficient roadmap. Understand where emissions come from. Decide your key partner in this journey and start measuring and cutting emissions. So what are we waiting for? The time to act and make an impact is now.
Leading companies worldwide.
Okay, sounds a little bit too trailer.
Well, that's a trailer guy voice coming out this summer, brought to you by CFO.
I'm glad you asked. No, that was terrible.
Because it's quite difficult to measure. It's quite difficult to measure. Because it's quite difficult to measure. Because it's difficult.
In this.
That's exactly, you see why